Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I want to clear up a misconception that I've heard several times, and you'll already know what that is if you look at this episode title, but I'm going to demonstrate really what the differences are. Now, I know immediately that there's going to be some of you that are going to say, well, of course I knew that. Everyone knows that. Who doesn't know that? Well, I can tell you lots of people don't know this because a lot of people don't think about or are aware of the intricate details for how these things are implemented in the C++ standard. And I see people use these things interchangeably in code reviews and such. And so I just want to clarify that a C++ lambda is not standard function. These are two completely different topics. Now you can convert a lambda into a function. I guess you could wrap a function with a lambda, but I'm hard pressed to immediately see a use case for that. But if we've got, and I'm going to make this just a silly example here. Let's say I have a lambda that can add two numbers. Okay, that's a lambda. Unused variable. So let's just go ahead and turn off WError right now because we need this for the sake of demonstration purposes here. All right, so we've got this function that's currently unused, and I'm going to go ahead and just return the value of add 4 plus 5 here, and we're going to see 9 is returned from main, removing 9 into the register A0. Fine. That's easy enough to reason about. This is a lambda. Now I'm going to take this back real quick, and we're going to look at an unoptimized build, and we're going to see a operator paren that has been created for us in the lambda, and then we're going to see that operator paren is going to add, well, actually this is a little bit harder to read with no optimizations at all, but the key here is going to be this bit. It's adding a 1 into a 0 and storing the results in a 0. So that's going to be y is a 1, x is a 0, the result is a 0, and we're going to return a 0 from the add function here. So it's relatively straightforward, but optimizations have been disabled, and it's generating 35 lines of assembly. If I turn on some optimizations, I expect this to, yes, completely go away again. Okay. So let's just look at the equivalent with a standard function. You declare a function, standard function like this. But all I've declared is a holder to a function. So if I were to try to do something like this, let's comment this out. Now, if I try to call func, this, well, we can see right here, it generates a call to throw bad function call. I haven't actually declared a function that does anything. This is a holder of a function. It is an abstraction of a function. It is not a function by itself. So it is a, to be clear, a lambda. So a standard function is a type erase wrapper around a callable, and a C++ lambda is a language construct that helps us define an anonymous function. So this is generating a fair bit of code for not actually doing anything. So let's just be nice about it. Let's go ahead and actually assign this thing our add lambda. So now it actually does something, and we can see that even at 01, the compiler has gotten very, very good at optimizing away this stuff. I'm going to go ahead and put it in C++ 11 mode then we can see it's still optimizing it away at 01. Now let's just, for the fun of it, go back a few compiler versions. All right, now we're at clang 9. And at 01, it is generating a considerable amount of code. The compiler hasn't learned how to optimize away this thing yet. If I take it up to 02, now it can. It adds 9 to 0 and returns that into a 0. There we go. That's interesting way of doing that. Interesting RISC-V optimization or something there. Taking this back to a newer version of Clang. Yeah, it does just a copy into A0. Fascinating. Okay, so if we've got O0, it has to generate all of this abstraction code. And if we're really, really lucky, it will optimize it away for us. And if we call the add function directly, it's still having to do all this work of setting this thing up, even though we're not actually utilizing it. And in the case of O0 with the lambda, it is just a fairly straightforward function call. So the lambda is a function. Standard function, arguably, is not a function. It is a type erased wrapper around a callable thing. Okay. This is all very abstract, I believe. So let's try to look at it another way. I'm going to not actually do any work here. I'm going to create a function that calls a callable. I'm going to use function pointer syntax for this, in this case. And I'm going to create a function called add. Okay, so this one takes a function pointer. Now, this is the kind of thing that has been built into the compiler since forever. And the code is exactly the same as what we were looking at previously. Let's just add a little bit of optimization here to it. There we go. So I can see the add function adds, oops, x plus 7. That's not what I meant to do. This is why you should always have your warnings enabled and take them seriously. So x plus y, it adds a 1 and a 0, stores the result in a 0. And then this function call, it's a function pointer. It knows that it has a function pointer and it needs to call something that exists at a certain memory address. And even at 03, I generate the exact same code. Okay, now I'm going to create a different version of call. And to someone who thinks of these things as being equivalent, maybe perhaps we'll see the difference here. Okay, so this is at 03 with an older compiler, but in this case, I know that it's a simple jump to whatever function was stored in A0. So A0 is going to be a function pointer, copies that to A5, and then it's going to jump to A5 after setting up A0 and A1, the values 2 and 3 that are being passed to the function. All right, and we can see approximately the same thing happening here. 2 and 3 being set up onto the call stack, and then it is going to jump into some memory location here. And we have the potential for a bad function call if the function object that was passed to us was empty. And this is with optimizations turned all the way on. Let's take optimizations back a little bit. And again, we can see that our version that takes a function pointer is going to set up some parameters to call. It's going to jump to whatever value. It's going to do its thing. Now that took 19 instructions. All right. And then this is everything that has to happen. And we can start to see some of this abstraction that's happening. And we're going to talk about this in a future episode. So I think hopefully I'm communicating correctly. Now, the point that standard function gives us, and you're wondering, okay, if it has all this extra overhead, then why does it even exist? And it's because it can take any callable kind of thing. So if I wanted to, I can have like a vector of standard functions. So I can have one that is a add, one that is a multiply, one that is a subtract, and that will all work. Now, if you have been paying attention and already know something about standard function and the abstractions that it provides and function pointers, then you might be thinking, wait a minute, I can do the exact same thing if I use function pointers here. And let's just go ahead and pull on optimization so we can start to take a look at this. That's O3. And this is generating a fair bit of code. I mean, it's a hand wavy kind of thing. Ooh, look at all the code that it generated, but it's generating a fair bit of code. Now remember, never ever copy paste, but I'm doing this for demonstration purposes. In this case, I could, in fact, create a vector of function pointers. This is actually a perfectly allowed thing to do. And it's helpful that a captureless lambda is implicitly convertible to a function pointer. And I have so many episodes on lambdas that you should go and look at one of those. But I can go ahead and also pass in an actual function pointer. Now, what this will not let me do is the more abstract case of saying, I have something like this. Let's say I want to capture a value and use this in my callable. I can't do this in the function pointer case because it's only a captureless lambda that is convertible implicitly or explicitly to a function pointer. So let's go ahead and do this version. And we can see that the standard function is going to work here. Now it generates considerably more code, of course. But this has a place. Sometimes you need this very abstract behavior. You need the type erased thing, the standard function that is callable on anything that happens to take that set of parameters. It's a lambda, it's a capturable lambda, it's a function pointer, it's a member function pointer, it's anything that can be called with that set of parameters can be used in the place of a standard function. And so I've decided that I'm going to go ahead and for every episode that I can, I'm going to go ahead and tie this back into the game engine that I introduced for the This Game Teaches C++ episode. All right, so yes, very bright screen. Sorry, I know some of you are going to complain about this. Why do I have a build failure here? Oh, that's right, because code coverage is so low at the moment. But it's a work in progress. So I actually have in my game logic, let's go ahead and look at game components. So for each location on the map, I have a standard function. This is the kind of thing that I would normally say, oh, well, you know, that's going to add more overhead than is necessary. But in this case, it is not more overhead than is necessary. I wanted to be able to make this as easy to program as possible. And taking a standard function, being able to say, hey, you know what, when you enter this tile, I want you to execute this thing that takes a reference to a game, a point, that's the point, the location on the map that was entered, and from which direction you entered the tile. So you can do whatever you want to there. So it's very flexible to do it this way. And also all of my draw routines are standard functions. So yeah, there's going to be a little bit of overhead where it's going to have to check and see if that function is currently empty. If it's not empty, then it has to jump to a location after setting up the function parameters. That's going to add more overhead, but it's overhead for the sake of flexibility in the game engine. And now this also gives me the possibility in the future of very easily letting these be script functions. Like chiscript would be perfect here because a chiscript function is convertible to a standard function. So I could easily plug chiscript in here if I wanted to. Although, you know, just to be clear, I haven't maintained chiscript in quite a while. Other people have been maintaining it. Or I could use, you know, something like sol2 or luabind or pybind11 or one of these things that can let you just get a standard function back for a function that exists inside the scripting language. And this would be a perfect use case for something like that. So yeah, I went a little bit deeper than I intended to, or maybe not as deep as I could have. I'm not entirely sure here. But yeah, a lambda is not a standard function. A lambda is a way of defining a callable object in C++. It's generated by the compiler for you. Standard function is a type erased wrapper around any kind of callable that gives you this generic interface that you can pass around. It's more flexible than a function pointer. So maybe this episode will be called something like standard function versus lambda versus function pointer. Maybe we'll call it something like that. So thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to subscribe and, you know, do the normal things.